starting, this is the screen I have drawn the last class. This is the grammar. This is the odd palindrome grammar. You can recognize the odd palindrome. Why is odd palindrome? S is equal to C, small c. Then we take first augmented grammar. We first try to make an augmented grammar. Some of your presentation is very good. Even most of the presentation is very good. But you have to show the step, this step. Everybody, some people have directly go to the Q0 state, dot S. No, actually the grammar, whatever the grammar is given in LR0 parsing, from starting from LR0, then the until and unless we understand the LR0, we cannot understand SLR, LLR and LR1. So you have to first make a extra S dash to S, that is we can make it a 0th rule or 1 dash rule, whatever, but this rule will not, that will be that, and other rules are like 1, 2, 3, that is the convention. Yeah, that is the augmented grammar. You can find the similarity, like whenever you are converting any grammar to Chomsky's normal form, remember you always take a new start variable, S0. Same concept here, because why you have taken that S0 at that time, whenever we are converting any context-free grammar to Chomsky's normal form, because S0, because I am taking the new variable cannot be there on the right-hand side. Same logic goes here. We are taking the extra production, S dash, and S dash is the extra state we are adding, that we will not come back. So I0 never will land. So ultimately it is a DFA, but sometimes we have seen that DFA, you can come back to your starting position. So we are making sure that the Q0 cannot be an accepting position. So that is the rule. So in the if you are taking augmented grammar, then definitely it will be Q0 dot your dot S dash goes to dot S, and it will never come back. Okay, that's the thing. And then we are, as we all know, it is always better, we will see it not in LR0, but is always better for all the variables you take the follow calculation. And you know, to calculate follow, you have to calculate first. And first calculation is much easier than follow. Here you can see S can have a follow dollar also, and can follow A and B. And we'll see that this particular grammar is okay for LR0, but later on, whenever you are reducing our rule, then we have to check, whenever we are reducing by rule, we have to check what is the, we look ahead and what is the follow of the variable. If it is matches, then we reduce, otherwise we reduce, rule can be different and we may send the error flag and all. So it is, we'll see to it from LR0 to SLR itself, not even LR1 also. This is SLR, LR1, LLR, basically same, they look at only one. So that is it. So whenever, I am not doing it here, fast and follow calculation, I am not doing it here. But what is the reason? Because here no conflict. Why I am saying conflict? From this picture, if you see, you don't have to go to table. Like whenever we go for our LL1 parsing table, at the LL1 parsing table, go and see there is no double entry, all are single entry, then you say yeah, you're definitely a LL1 parsing. But you, before that you can tell, because if you're all the right hand variable to all strings, say capital A to alpha beta gamma, if you say first of alpha, first of beta, first of gamma, intersection is psi, there is no and no left recursion. And if say any variable A goes to epsilon, and we say fast of A and follow of A intersection is psi, we can tell immediately that the grammar is LL1, otherwise not. But you can go to the parsing table, that extra effort you need, and then you can definitely show. Same is here, you don't have to go for this diagram, you have to do this diagram first. I believe this is the graph you have to better do, like whenever you go the dot. This is augmented grammar. Now after augmented grammar, you put dot here. So at Q0, S dash dot S, S to dot, we have to, because I put the dot S, So all the S transition I have to put it here, all the dots, and this is Q0, and it cannot be accepted state. So that's it. So if we put S dash to dot S, it will go to S dash to dot S. It can be a final state. It can be, because there can be, you know, in a DFA there are many number of final states. So S dash to dot S, that they are the no other rule which are not in final state. So we keep a concentric circle. This is my addition of drawing. I do not find any other books, but it is give a value addition. So you can see this is a particular state, only one, and one reduction rule, S dash to S dot, because whenever dot is here, that you have seen the string before, and now you can reduce it to S dash, and so I make it a Q1, is a concentric circle. Same whenever the A is given, so I come to S to A dot SA, and because dot S is there, all the rules will be repeated here. So Q2, and so definitely it is, dot is here at the first position, not middle position, here in the first position, it cannot be final state. And if A's are coming, so it will be always there. If B is coming, it goes to this, is B dot SP. Again, all the rules, because dot S, all the rules are repeated, so it can also not be final state. So it is. But okay, these are not confusing, but if I find any state where final state and non-final states are there, then definitely it cannot be done by LR0, that is guaranteed. And we will go to next stage, the Q2. If you are Q2, the AS is coming, we go for another step ahead. Even AS dot, it is also not final, but after getting A, I am getting AS dot, ASA dot. So this is ASA dot, is a accepting state, so I can take it as a final state as a DFA. I put a concentric circles around it, and here if I put it, say here Q3 to S, I go to B dot S P. Again, it is not a final state. Then after P, I go to BS B dot, and yes, it is a final state, and that is it. Sorry, in this diagram it is not there. I am very extremely sorry. So I after getting this. We draw this same thing. Sorry, unfortunately, the last section is not there. This is a sample string and how it is parsed. What is the summary of the things I must tell? All the diagrams, unfortunately, this rectangle is not visible, but these are all single rule, either dot at the end, that is an accepted state, and otherwise, but there is no such state where shift and reduce conflict is there. Which can be a state which is shift and reduce conflict? In some boxes, say if it is a go to Q2, in some boxes dot at the end, so we can reduce it, and dot at the middle, then it's a conflict. So whether I reduce it or whether I shift it. So that is called shift reduce conflict is pretty simple. We can avoid it by look ahead one. We'll see it, and then so here we have to see that. Here we don't need look ahead, because all the states are either final accepting state or non-final state. So they are the perfect example of LR0. So I think you now understood what is the basic characteristic of LR0 grammar. LR0 grammar, the main thing is whenever you draw these canonical items collection from the diagram itself, you don't have to go table. From the diagram itself, if you find that and another thing you must find, there will be no reduced state also. In particular state, LR0, the very easy. Achha, what is, why, from where we are coming to LR0? LR0 is nothing but shift reduce grammar. Remember, shift reduce, if there is no conflict, that is a basically LR0. Okay, shift. And then when the LR0, there will be conflict if we found a rectangle where a dot at the end, and it's, but not are all final items. Then is a conflict. Whether I'll shift it, whether I'll reduce it. And another dangerous, more serious it is in a single box. It's a single box is a final state, but two rules are there. Maybe both are final state. Then it is called reduce conflict. So they, unfortunately, in this, it's a pretty simple grammar. So it is not there. So that is the reason I am showing it, that it is LR0 grammar. And then reduce. Then we have to see. Whenever you are reducing the variable, we have to look which rule we are by reducing, by this rule number one, then you will see S, then the follow of S, and any rule, the follow of this, if it is look at, then you look at the input string. See, LR0, they don't look at anything after taking the symbol, they do not look at plus one. Then you look at plus one and you see the input buffer, just one symbol, and if it comes in your follow of that grammar, yes, then you can reduce it as per the follow. So that is the reason in LR0, whenever you are reducing it, all the row items will be ruled by same, like R3, 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 R1, R1, R1. Because why I am R3, R3, R3? I am not checking it, follow of next. So it will definitely not. So if the follow of the things is matching, say, in particular will follow the BC, then we'll put BC, R3, R3, not A. And one of the great advantage of, if you always check the follow, then you can raise an error. That is the reason from LR0 to LR1 or SLR or LLR, we can immediately detect error. Whenever you're reducing it, then if you see the what are the input next terminal which is coming, which is not matching the follow characters, the follow may consist of dollar or maybe other terminals, it is not matching, then definitely there is an error. So you can always raise the error and tell it. So that is the beauty of follow. And so it is always a good practice whenever you are getting a grammar, you always calculate fast and follow. And fast and follow, we learned it from LL1 grammar, that is very helpful. But here you see we need the follow, not fast. But whenever you are calculating fast of the variable, you need follow of the variable, you need the fast as well. That's it. Yeah, I think there should be no doubt. Let's go for the next slide. Yeah, this I am taking from, I'll send this PDF note. This I am taking from all Professor Gautam Basu, IIIT Kollani. The PDF is available. I'll send it to you right now. So that is very good slides. So I am making the slides from there. The same thing, whatever, this is the grammar, the discussing the last, it's LR0 parsing. Next slide, please. Yes, this I have already told. An LR0 item is complete if dot at the end, yes. And the interesting property of this LR0 DFA is that no state is formed with both complete and incomplete items. That I have told you repeatedly. No. So any state, if it has a complete and incomplete item, then they definitely not LR0. A state in unique complete item, A to alpha dot, indicate reduced section by those. And actually, whenever go to LR1, the number of states will be more. Even if the reduce by the same rule, but as far the if the follow are the same, say you are reducing by the rule by S to say there are several S to A, say S to B, S, B. So if they use the same rule, but as per different follow, the your state will be different. So in LR0, number of states, LR1 number of states will be much more in your parsing table. Why? Because in any state, accepting state, there cannot be two reduce. Okay, that's one. So that there cannot be two reduce function. So only one reduce function. If the reduce function is used for several follow variations, same, then we have a different states as well. Because as per the different follow, I am using a different state. Maybe same reducing function, but SLR, whatever you do, we will combine. The same reduce functions, reduce one for different follow variable A, B, C, they will put in the same state. So that is the number of states are much less in SLR, simple LR or LALR. So that is the reason. That is the number of states are much more in LR1, but LR1 I found it easier to understand. That LR1 means in any accepted state, you have only one and only single rule as per the follow. For each different follow, you have a separate, same rule, but separate state. Yes. So, a state with a complete item A to alpha dot indicate reduce section using, yeah, that I have already told you. Yes, this is, it is the same, the drawing, I have shown it in our board in the last class. This is, yeah, this is important, I have told you number of, in case LR0 parser, it does not look at even a, for any reduce operation. Yes, that is one, doesn't look at it, so I am not calculating follow. It gets the current state from the top of the stack, yes, and production rules from the parsing table for connect, and reduces write sequential. Okay. So another thing I must tell you, sometimes I told you in the same stack, you are using that particular terminal and state on the top of it, that is easier to visualize, but actually it may be a different stack altogether, two different stack, one stack with the only states only and another stack with the terminal. We'll call that as a semantic stack, because we'll start semantic analysis also. So though easier to understood as per my logic, easier to, you have a using a single stack, you are initialized with dollar and initialized with Q0, but Q0 never be a accepting state. Then you know the ultimate start variable S or E should come and Q1 should come. So final stack will be dollar and then I0, then your start symbol S and I1. This is the final position. Actually, it is a two stack basically. One stack contains the state information, actually that drives your parsing table, and another is, you can call it a semantic stack, where actual terminals would be there. But for understanding, you can visualize both. Okay, so this is, that is it. This is the parsing. I have shown it. I'll show it in a separate video. I can show it in a separate day. This is the rules I used. Now you are going for another grammar, which is not LR0 parsing. This is a mistake parsing. This is LR1. This is not LR1 parsing. We'll see what is the why it is LR1. This is, today we are starting with this grammar. This is the correct. This is SLR1 parsing. See, we are taking a rule number one. This is, we are taking it as just. It is called augmented grammar. So augmented grammar, I have taken the diagram. I have calculated. I will see it. See it right now quickly. This is my hand-drawn picture. I will suggest you, please, everybody, please do this exercise for all the grammar. Then it will be clear. Most of you have done it in the presentation. Very thankful, and that will help you understand. This is the original grammar, context-free grammar, definite unambiguous, and this is the variables, H dash and L. This is the terminals. Then I am using, this is the Q0, H dash, say Q0, when the P comes, say it goes to H dash to P dot, and this is the accepted state, this way, and another thing we have calculated, we'll see that in particular transaction there is the final item mixing and this thing. I'm checking it where it is occur. This thing, Q4, this is the mark. I have said Q4 and Q11. How we go to Q4? Say this is Q0, we are here, then we are getting say m.lac, and then all the L will be derived. Then from there, from Q4 we go D dot L. Say another D comes, D here comes, and so we have got it. This is the D comes, D dot L, and it goes to dot. So here we see L is equal to D dot. This is a complete reduced function. Very good. But D dot L, it is not reducible function. Others are not reducible function. So this is Q4, and if you go for Q11, there also you find it that D dot is a reducible, but this is, others are not reducible. So we will find, but all other states, this is a final state. Okay, T is equal to F dot, excellent. This is a, after getting F, say if we go for this, after getting F, we are coming here. This is a Q7, this is a final state, accepting state. And T to I dot, after I, you got it, this state. Q6, very good. This is accepted state, but other states are no problem at all. They are, but Q4 and Q11, we find the state there is L to D dot is there, and Q11 V D dot is a final state, reducible state, but other non-reducible state. So whenever you come up this diagram, definitely after any grammar, you don't have to even calculate the follow and all these things. I will come to this follow, these things. So you first do this diagram, it is LRC writing correction. So that is one simple thing for any grammar, unambiguous grammar. If you have to draw the parsing table by hand, then you have to go for LRC writing correction. But then whenever you see, if there is no, every state is great, good, no problem, final state only contains final state, no mix up. If it's a mix up like here, Q4 and Q11, then your alarm bell rises. That means your this is your, whenever you are, whether you reduce it or shift it, you have to go for the follows. Like L is equal to D dot, then I have to check the follow of L. If we look ahead one particular terminal which matches follow of L, then we'll reduce it. Otherwise, we'll not reduce it. So that is, then you go for the follow and fast calculation. We require the follow, but you know, the to calculate follow, you have to calculate fast. See here, P definitely dollar, because P doesn't come on the right hand side. Then always the dollar should be the follow. Then the L, what is the L should be follow, because L also, L follow definitely S should be there, because in rule number one, MLAC, S is there, so S is there. And how the I and F come? Let's check how the I and F come. L, this is L. The first of D will come, because L to goes to the first of D will come. First of D is coming, first of T is coming I and F. So that is the reason the L dollar and the first follow of D is IFS. And first of L is IFS. So this portion, I think you know first and follow calculation. If any doubt, you can tell me. This is because whenever we will reduce it, we'll see it. So whenever we come to rule the left hand, if we rule the left hand is D, then we have to check what is the follow in the input. What is the follow? If the follow is I, we have another rule. Follow of A, maybe another rule, AC is another rule, maybe all the rules are same, then we can fill up like LR0, you know, by the same rule number. But it will be right now, whenever you go for SLR or LR1, you should use the rule with forward slash with follow. So the follow of this, you have to reduce and say forward slash I, forward slash F, forward slash S. That is the follow of your left hand side of the variable. That is this, the drawing, I am extremely sorry, drawing is bad, and I am putting it here, dot here, that is LR0, no red dot here. Red dot means is a error condition. Any vacant positions are our error positions, and we will subsequently see if the vacant position comes, if you see the follow, then we can put error root in. Basically, it is nothing but a table and nothing but a switch case. It is in C or Java, Python. It is basically switch case, if then else type, nested if then else or switch case. And if we can found anything vacant there, we can put a error routine like Java or Python. We can a exception clause there, so it will come out and giving you error on the stack. You can see that the error is coming you whenever you run the GCC. So we can put the this is actually not blank. Whenever you are programming, then other cases you have a definitive action, and others you put your error routine. So that's great. So let's go to the next slide. Interesting property. This is already repeated. This repeated. Sorry for this. These are repeated. I already told. Yeah, this is an extremely good slide. I found it from the same. This is a great, because this is a some LR, basically bottom up parsing, shift reduce parsing LR. First left, L is left to right scanning, never right to left scanning. That is sometimes it is difficult to have. It is always a left to right scanning until always Urdu language. It is always, fortunately, all programming languages are English language, and it's a left to right. Okay, now what is the difference between top down and bottom up? We try to handle we are scanning and we try to catch by the what is the last derivation used in top-down parsing. Like in any parsing, the top-down try to catch the first derivation like human do. But in bottom-up parsing, whenever you are think is a top-down parsing, last derivation you have used to get the string, and that is always available as a handle. And I have told you unambiguous grammar, this is only one and only handle. But the conflict will be your handle is there, then whether you reduce, shift or reduce, that is one type of conflict, or reduce by two rules, then we can decide. You will look ahead to the input buffer, see only one terminals, and you match it. You have a reduced rule, you have a context free grammar, so left hand side should be a single variable only. You have already calculated follow of that variable, and if it matches that particular rule, then the question can becomes if that matches, but there are two rules. Yeah, that is critical. Maybe it is there could be ambiguous grammar, then it will helpless. Even LR1 also helpless. So if it matches follow, and then it is a two rules is there, it should not be. Anyway, so that is the way. So basically, what is the bottom-up parsing is, we try to catch the last derivation, and we always, whenever there is a handle, whenever this is created, this is handle is coming, like this is always a whenever anything unknown is there, it is waiting for handle. So this is one handle, this is one handle, this is one handle, this is the last handle. So it is a basically rightmost derivation in reverse. Some people call rightmost, but you have to, this is 2R basically. LR parsing, R means rightmost derivation in reverse. Basically, ideally it should be called LRR. I don't know, probably then it will be less confusion. It's a leftmost derivation, it should be LDRR. Rightmost derivation in reverse. 2Rs. That's it. As a parser reads input from left to right, the first reduction is the last step of the derivation of the leftmost end. That is very vital, that is called handle. Input farther away from the left end were produced by earlier steps derivation. And reduction takes place following the sequence of rightmost derivation is reversal. That is important. 2R is there. Rightmost derivations in reversal. Okay, so that is, I have already. That is the concept called the stack, value stack, and semantic stack. I will discuss. That is already, you know, go to action. This is okay. This I have already discussed in details in another class. I have already discussed. But I must tell that everybody is starting with your presentation. There are only two kinds of parsing. No, there are many kinds of parsing. One is top down. The best example is LL1. That is non-recursive deterministic LL1, best example of top-down parsing. And lot of language can be derived by the LL1, even Python also. And then comes the bottom-up. The bottom-up, everybody straight goes to the LR parser. No, first bottom-up, the easiest example is the operator precedence grammar, where the operator should be between two variables, and no two variables should be together, and no variables can go to epsilon. Yeah, that is always true as Chomsky's normal form. The Chomsky's normal form, you remember that right hand side only two variables, and no variable can go to epsilon other than start variable, and the right hand side can only go. But Chomsky's normal form is not operator precedence grammar. I must correct it. Because Chomsky's normal form, right hand side, two variables, they are together. So that cannot be operator precedence grammar. So that is a bad example. Chomsky's normal form is a bad example. Operator precedence grammar. Operator precedence grammar, right hand side only two variables, but operator should be in between. So definitely the Chomsky's normal form. Okay. But no variable can go to epsilon. That is similar to Chomsky's normal form. Okay. So, but that is a operator precedence grammar. Then comes the shift reduce grammar. Then shift reduce grammar is okay, but if it's a conflict is shift or reduce, between shift and reduce, or reduce to reduce, then we have to go for LR0 item collection. See, LR0 item collection is very, very vital. It is true for SLR, LLR, LR1. Then when you are making a table, then from Elizer item collection, you have to select the rule as per the, whenever you are reducing by rule number 3, R1, R2, you are reducing by R1, then your R1, you have to check the left hand side of the variable and you see the follow of those variables, which are the things, and then you reduce as per the follow. So whenever you are filling the LR0 table, whenever you are filling each row by all R1 or R2, it will not be, it will only if it matches with the follow of the row, so you have to calculate follow. Very easy. LR0 item collection is same, you don't have to do, and only you have to calculate follow of the your variables, not terminals. You know, follow of the terminals doesn't have any use, and the start variable always have a dollar at the follow, and if the start variable doesn't go left hand side, so start variable always go generally the dollar only, and then the your this one but for follow calculation you require the fast, so that is, it is better to calculate both fast and follow. Okay, so there this bottom up parsing, but another two parsing I have told, in fact another I have always discussed in the last three classes, that is another parsing, and that is the best example of parsing. Most context-free grammar is parsed by CYK algorithm or early parsing, two different types. CYK again a bottom-up, but it is not left to right or left. It can be, it searches what are the known strings, like we do our image understanding, or whenever we reading newspaper, we do not go like noun clause, verb clause. No, but actually we learn grammar later, maybe at the age of 9, when you are in maybe class 1, class 2, class 3, maybe now the kindergarten. I never in kindergarten. Anyway, we generally start speaking without knowing the grammar. Actually, that is the Chomsky's innate grammar. Chomsky's forms, they say, basically 99.9% language all over the world, they have a all child between 0 to 2 years, whenever they speak with their parents or other, they learn the language like this. And it has been found that most of this language coming like this, a repetitive clause is there, like context-free grammar or context-sensitive grammar. One clause is maybe noun clause, verb clause, the verb clause will contain noun clause. So it is a repetitive grammar. So these things we generally read in newspaper, we do not read by noun clause, verb clause, that thing. We try to do what are the known phrases, so it is not left to right or right to left. So this is another kind of parsing that is called CKY or CYK. Both are same. This is the CYK and CKY, and then early parsing. CYK is a bottom-up parsing. Early parser is a top-down parsing. These are two interesting. Unfortunately, they are not in the syllabus, but you can, if somebody of you give a CFA presentation, that will be great. Okay. Now go to the next stage, the semantic analysis. But one thing I must tell you, that there is a concept called pass 1 and pass 2 and pass 3. Most of the 99% of the compiler, they go to pass 2 is enough, or maybe another pass 3. See, we interpreter, we need only pass 1. You know, interpreter do not go loop around. You just give it, you do it immediately. Bang, at that time. So, interpreter that way is a fast. Whenever you give a bunch of codes to interpreter, in pass 1, if it goes to pass 1 and pass 2, pass 3, then to the compiler, it will be slower. It will not be no use in like Python and modern interpreter-based languages. So semantic analysis, remember, whenever the pass one always consists of lexical analysis, yeah, because lexical, it gives the basically tokens, and a lot of errors can be found out with some variable name which starts with numeric, and like this lot of, or semicolon is semicolon missing sometimes, you have to go syntax analysis test. Common is the variable naming and all these things. Then it goes to, when the lexical analysis, they are building the symbol table. Symbol table is very vital. Then syntax analysis also, they are augmenting the symbol table. Then what the semantic analysis does, semantic analysis say, whenever we are reducing action by, you know, the ultimate output will be parse tree, but we generally stop calling parse tree, we call abstract syntax tree, ASN tree. You know, difference between parse tree and abstract syntax tree is nothing but your nodes will be operation and your leaves will be operands. So that is it. And whenever you are reducing, put to a your left hand side variable, whether any errors are there, whether float is coming to int or int is coming to float or char is going to float. node in your road, that analysis is done by semantic analysis. So what I want to say that you have is, you know, the seven stages. Simple tape. Before that, your first is checking lexical analysis, then comes your syntax analysis or parsing. We are giving more time in parsing, then semantic analysis. Within semantic analysis, then comes the intermediate code generation. After semantic analysis and intermediate code generation at the same stage, and then comes the target specific, which machine you are running, whether you are the code is running on mobile or your desktop or maybe other place. So the target specific code generation and two optimization take place. One, machine independent optimization, another is machine dependent code optimization. So both are very necessary. Machine independent, you know, right now Java, Python, they have intermediate code. So that is a good convention, intermediate code optimization. Then actually when the it runs on particular machine, it's a deal, then you can use C, Python and like this, then you can have intermediate code generation. So the maximum pass is three. One pass, they go for syntax and semantic and error. Then again, another pass, it goes for, but no passes cover second time. So this code generation, you have two types of code generation. Machine independent first, there are some optimization. If we have some loops, then the concept will be loop optimization. We'll come to it today that within the loop, the loop is very much used. So within the loop, content will be minimum. If anything, code should be very minimum without disturbing the logic. But if the outer of the code is goes heavy, no issue, because that code is used only one or two times. So that's it. We'll come to this. A semantic action, we'll just check whenever you reduce it by B and C to A, whether that is matching. That is what is the parsing, cannot catch some errors, some language constructs are not context free, some scoping. Yeah, that is in C, Java, you declared the variable earlier. So that is not by any rule. So that is handled by separately. But Python doesn't have to declare. So that way it is a more context free language. I think this will be clearer. Another thing is static analysis and dynamic analysis. You all know the Python is a dynamic, so it will be checking it here in interpreter. And semantic dynamic checking, say, this checks whether the array variable goes out of this and all. This can be done by semantic at the static time. Before, at the time of compilation, you can, if you check that your code, you see if your array position is 100, if it goes 101, 102, that array out of bound indication can be given at the static checking, that before compilation. So modern day code, you know, Python, these are all the dynamic, so an exception will come at the dynamic. So it will be a little slower dynamic checking, but there's lots of other advantages there. Yeah, that is, here I am, after parsing we have done. Now we have agreed that we will go for bottom up parsing, maybe LLR parsing, we'll go for it. LR1 is the best one, but LR1 will be too heavy because, you know, many states will be there. For many variables, many terminals, states are built, but LR1 is ideal. More 99% of the languages comes to LR1. So we already have a parse tree or abstract syntax tree you've got. Then we got for the semantic analysis and intermediate code generation. This is very vital. Then machine independent code improvement here. That is one stage. Then target code and machine specific code generation. So these portion of the syllabus are remaining, and the symbol table is always there. Symbol table is improved. Scanner puts some entries, the symbol table goes to improve here. And I must tell you, the symbol table is basically used by a dictionary, like a dictionary concept in Python. It should be symbol table, not a single monolithic table. It will be not. It will be different symbol table for different scoping functions. So it just be very fast. Whenever you are searching things, it should be fast. So it can be done by dictionary, by hashing, like collection. Like this way, symbol table is made that way. It should be very fast because it has to be accessed all the time till the error generation. You have to put the symbol table. And one, if you are debugging code, if you put some portion of symbol table, put into your output code, that is, you are in debugging mode, then that code will be too. That, but whenever you are sure that your code is running, you can take out this code. Your ultimate A dot out will be smaller in size. So that's it. See, intermediate code generation, yes, front end, intermediate back end, that you have told. It is intermediate code is very vital that you understand. Intermediate code, this is interesting. In any intermediate code, it will be three address code, and we always have writer side will be always a only one operator is allowed. So we try to break. It is more like assembly language. If you, ultimately your instructions will be make it, we make a three address code. All instruction. If you have a very complex thing, ultimately it will serialize of three address code. Your left hand side is one, and right hand side only one operator, like operator precedence grammar, and you calculate it, then you do this. So this is steps. Like this is your abstract syntax tree. I have told you this is output of your LR1 parser or SLR parser. This is different from parsing tree. Whatever we have learned in on automata, it is a abstract syntax tree. Operations, all operations here, and all the operations should be broke like a three address code. And now we try to improve the three address code this way. We can do it. This is the three address code. I just quickly tell you that this one is a thing. If this is the your operation, it cannot be done once. So you have to calculate. You all know the all arithmetic operation done right way. You see language also. So first you calculate T1 and then T2 is equal to X plus T1. So if you find this kind of code, it cannot be done in one. First the T1 will be Y star J will be calculated. Star as a more star as more power, you know the expression grammar. So T2, and then this is one directed acyclic graph will be there, and this is your ultimate machine language. This is a intermediate code will be there, and we have to improve this code like loop optimization, like anything you see here in a loop. So like a loop starts with while this. So we'll first check this before, and we do not do any complex condition checking within the body. So because when the loop will be executed, every time it will be executed, whatever we do, we'll check it outside and we make it a simple check, and then we'll make a simple check with this one is every time we go, okay, fine. But if we have an unnecessary portion here, so this is called a motion of the code motion. So any loop, if we can found that it can be calculated outside the loop, then we should do it. And this kind of while checking, we just make only this kind of less than greater than check, nothing else. If we have a very complex check there, then we do it outside, because if it's within loop, lot of time will be there. And this is ultimately done by the compilers. The compilers are right now very intelligent, maybe artificial intelligence analysis, they can detect this.